You are tuning in to the Matt Jasa Glassblowing Channel. I'm putting some nice radiant heat into the end of this blow tube. It's a 12 millimeter heavy wall. So I have a pretty awesome experiment to show you, but before I do that, I need some distilled water. So I was thinking I could head to the store and pick some up out of a jug. It'd be pretty quick. But then I was thinking, you know what? I have everything here to distill some water myself. Why not do it right here in the shop? And now that that flare is attached, I'm just gonna rotate on axis to make sure that the other blow tube's very straight. Also, it'll end up lopsided when I'm done. I'll go ahead and focus a good amount of heat into the middle, make a nice glowing band, and start melting it into two separate blanks. One will be a small round bottom boiling flask, while the other one will be a Erlenmeyer flask. I have a lot of gathered up glass here from the separation. I'm just gonna go ahead and heat it up and give it a little puff to even it out. And one of the main goals, especially when you're puffing out the glass or, you know, blowing out spheres, is just to keep the walls very even, the same thickness all the way around. It might be kind of hard to see how thick it is in the video, but in person you can really tell. One thing I wanted to talk about real quick too, if you are interested in glass blowing, if it's an art you want to pursue, I definitely recommend it. You know, I would definitely say go for it. And I say that because there's a few people out there that will kind of make it seem like it's harder than it is, you know, or you have to kind of go down the same path they did, go with the same teachers and such. And it's like, no, I mean, it really just comes down to dedication, you know, practice. You know, how dedicated are you to being a great glassblower? And I haven't had any lessons yet from anyone. I've just been teaching myself from online resources, kind of like this, just videos. And with that boiling flask puffed out, I'm gonna go ahead and grab the claw grabbers and try to leave a little hole when I tear off the blow tube. And I've gotten a lot more comfortable with these small holes and using the flame. I mean, it's kind of even hard to see here on the camera what it looks like. I'll just go ahead and melt that chamber back a little bit, kind of thicken it up, leaving a lot of extra glass for this new tool I'm going to demonstrate here, the Gong Tool, the glass on glass. It's basically a brass reamer, but it has a very slight taper. That way, when you match it up with the other Gong Tool, you can make a nice fitting. It definitely takes some practice, but if you do it right, you can get an airtight fit, which is great for like a perfume bottle because it'll keep the perfume from evaporating. Like I said, there's two of them. And so then I use the male tool to make a female fitting. And then I'll here pretty soon use the female tool to make a male fitting. You want to get them waxed up really well when you use them. That way they slide easier. And here you'll see I don't push it all the way in. That way I don't have it fall through. And now that that's complete, I'll go ahead and just toss that in the kiln for about an hour and get on to the male fitting. Now this side can be a little bit tricky. You heat it up, stick it under the tool, and puff into the glass, and it'll form to that taper you need for the female section. And now that that's formed, I'll go ahead and start pulling off bits of the end to thin it out so I can open it up. Nice little puff there, gets it open. And I'll try to open up a little bit, but I, like I said before, I need to be careful not to disrupt that taper because it's only about a millimeter or two. And unfortunately, my camera ran out of room and it cut out when I was doing the U-bend, which would have been really cool to see. Now, this will be another two-parter. I really feel the experiment deserves its own video. It's going to be probably a bit shorter than this one, but this is just mainly the prep work and kind of the fun stuff. I had a lot of fun doing this one too. It's very empowering to know you can just kind of make your own lab as a scientist. And smash! I'm gonna try to puff and pull it out to rip out a hole, and I gotta go really slow so nothing crazy happens. And something crazy happens. Basically what happened there, the walls just got really, really thin because it puffed out very quickly. And I wish I had a microscope to try to judge how thin the glass got. And it's just kind of crazy to me how quickly the physics just seem to change or act a little bit differently when you go to that extreme scale. You might start to get into quantum mechanics when you talk about scales like that. And personally for me, I don't really think it's as different when it comes to the physics. I just think it's more about the observations are just insanely hard or insanely different. And on top of that, just how we're perceiving the data in a mathematical sense. I mean, like the data, the math is perfect. You know, I'm not arguing that. It's just how we're applying that into a real world perspective. Now, this process is good to learn. It's swiping the glass. It's to clean up imperfections. And you just rotate the rod to kind of gather it up. And it's a lot about heat placement. You want to heat up more of the problem area you're swiping and less of the rod. And the reason I'm not putting a gong fitting on this one is just because I don't want to build up pressure. And with that complete, I'll go ahead and put it in the kiln. 1050. For about an hour should do it. And here's some of that glass that exploded out into really thin debris. We normally call it bubble trash. It kind of sticks to your finger like saran wrap or something. Here you'll see those crazy properties I was talking about. This is glass, mind you, and it is insanely flexible. Look at that. Bends so easy. And it still does shatter though, because it's glass. So I'll go ahead and set everything up to distill the water for the next video. And for the heat source, I'll be using this glass candle I've been working on. It doesn't have a traditional wick. It's a glass tube that sucks the fuel up to create this small pinpoint flame. Almost forgot I need to add the water to the boiling flask, of course. And let's set everything up, get this candle lit, and see what happens. And I keep calling it a candle, it's more of a small oil lamp. I filled it with isopropyl alcohol, that's all I have here in the shop. I never could find like a good round wick at the store, they're always the flat ones, so I figured I'd just make one out of glass. And I'll turn off the light so you can see the little flame action happen. And I think it's starting to work. I see some moisture kind of building up on the walls there. It's really starting to pick up now. I'm gonna readjust the camera a little bit to see inside. See these little like thunderbolts of water coming down, reflecting from the light. And then there's this weird thing that just starts happening here. It kind of reminds me of in, you know, the movies or video games where you're traveling between galaxies. There's like a huge distance you have to make up. So you go through a warp portal, and that's what it reminds me of, like going through one of those portals and just like zoo zoo. Anyway, now I received a good question on one of my videos I wanted to bring up here, and I'm not sure if it was the glass chain or the cannon, but they were asking if the glass, the scrap glass, is recyclable, like in the end of the cannon episode where I blew up the glass castle, could that be recycled into the next project? And yes, it is recyclable, but the problem with small-scale studios is it's a little bit cheaper just to start fresh with a new piece of glass. Because instead of taking that time to recycle it, you'll just take that time to make a new product. And you can make up your losses a little bit quicker. But personally, I do like to recycle it as much as I can. Real quick here, you'll see it's working. The water is distilling right through. And for the experiment coming up in the next video, it only needs a drop at a time, so this is going to be plenty for me. And it's been running a little bit, it's looking pretty cool. And it is running a little low in water here, I might have to refill it. But the oil lamp, you can see the fuel is still almost near the top. It's been running for quite a while with that little flame going. And I think I'll just go ahead and wrap up the video there. Thanks for watching, everyone. Everything turned out really well. So I'll be doing the experiment tonight. So make sure to check back tomorrow morning for part 2 of this episode. Don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button. Have your friends subscribe. I'll see you later. So I came back to check the lamp. It's still going. It's been about 5 hours since I lit it. I was just trying to run the fuel out to see how long it would last. And there's still some left. I'm thinking jack-o'-lantern.